This event, pardon for my casual attire, but I looked more like a student today, but I didn't get my own change of my clothes before this. And this event is in an ongoing series, the Eureka College Inclusive Excellence Dialogue series that was instituted by Dr. Wright, and designed to give the community a platform to address critical issues, questions, and voice their perspectives, your perspectives, about key social issues. And to give you students an opportunity to hear people who have experience in those particular areas. And so I'm moderating and facilitating the conversation. And we want to also tell you that this is kind of our future path in many ways, is more intentionally creating opportunities like this for dialogue. Not just to learn about issues, but to learn how dialogue works. Because it's not just about knowledge and information. It's about relationships and learning how to hear and listen and present your ideas. So it's very important. So we want this to be a candid conversation that's characterized by respect. And it can be a range of perspectives. So don't be afraid of contributing to the questions or comments. So we can move our whole campus community, our learning community, in the direction of inclusive excellence. Because I think in our society we've been modeled very clear negative examples of when dialogue is not engaged in a fluid way, in a responsible, respectful way. We have many, many examples that we could go into. But if you can graduate after a few years being here and being more comfortable in your skin, talking about issues that are difficult, then maybe we've done what we need to do, at least part of it. So thank you again, also to Multicultural Student Union for helping with this, and also for the 10-Minute Play Festival. It was very supportive of us doing this, and to Dr. Wright for making sure that this is an opportunity that we didn't miss. we're going to videotape this so that we can have this for future conversations. Michaela was the director for the 10-Minute Play, and Naomi was an actor in the show, and Riley was an actor in the show. Any others?
No, not right
here. So I know that we would want to get, your reflections on what it was like to inhabit those characters, but also those issues, right? If you wish to participate in that way, so. So it's going to be a moment where I'll introduce them and they can make an opening statement, and then it's a matter of Q&A. Is that cool? All right, so I think you probably know all these esteemed individuals, but it's my honor to introduce them again to you today. Dr. Rodriguez. Professor since 1992 in history. Dr. Lally could not make it due to the weather. He's a professor of criminal justice since 2012. Officer Tony Maxison, who also is trying to get here, I believe. who is our new police officer? Duane Bruce, Dean of Students. And of course, Dr. Jamel Sanders Wright, President of the College. I'm Chaplain Bruce, and I'm here to look pretty.
You're doing a great job. Something a little coffee. Oh, sure. Want me to start? Sure, okay. So, thank you all for being here, first of all, because even though I think many, if not all of you all live on campus, A, you can always be doing other things. B, it's freezing cold outside, so your commitment to staying and engaging in this conversation means a lot. And I think is absolutely telling of you all's dedication that you understand that each and every person on this college campus has a role to play in terms of solutions, in terms of engaging one another in this type of dialogue. So thank you all for being here this evening. I think many of you all know this, don't know what all of you all know about me. So I'm not just sitting here because I'm the president of Eureka College, but I am a communication scholar by training. And I spent 13 years teaching at various institutions. In addition to strategic communications and PR, my other area was intercultural communication and media. So I spent many years not only researching, writing about, presenting different topics, but also training individuals in the community and on the campuses where I've served as it pertains to what we now call intercultural understanding, which is one of our new 10 essentials for the curriculum that faculty completely overhauled and rolled out this fall semester. So I'm very excited about that, and I'm always eager to engage students and with students on some of these challenging topics. When I taught on the first day of class, I would always tell students that if they got through the end of the semester and never felt uncomfortable, that I should probably be fired. Because it is absolutely our jobs, as you all are now at this level of your education and preparing for the world beyond this place, that you experience discomfort, because experiencing discomfort is what actually leads to growth. So when I heard that Michaela here had taken on the challenge of directing the play, Love Her Black, and what the topic of that conversation focused on, I thought this was a great opportunity, especially for those who saw it, and maybe for others who didn't, where that could be a pretty heavy topic. And so to have a 10, 15, 20 minute play and to just leave it there just didn't seem like that was something that we should do, but that we should seize the moment of opportunity that these courageous actors took up and director took up to actually showcase for us a real, intense, emotive social issue that continues to be discussed and is right in our faces every time we turn around and every time we turn on the news. So a couple of things that I'll say as far as what I would like to just throw out on the table before we transition to the next introduction and opening statement. One of the things that really was interesting to me, and I overheard this statement, and initially I kind of chuckled. It was a student, a black male student, who had seen the play, and he said, you know, okay, so now I have to go work on my PTSD. So it was kind of, initially I kind of said, huh, and then I thought, wait a minute, that's at a minimum a tongue-in-cheek kind of statement. There's some truth to that for that student and for many students, right, who may look like him, where there is this moment as you're watching this play, right, Love Her Black, where it could spark for you things that are in your everyday real life situation and scenario and setting. And so I offer to you all with that being said, and one other thing, I guess, I think you all know this too, that I had the, I guess, I call it an opportunity. It was probably the most challenging one of my life, other than being a parent, but serving on the Ferguson Commission. And so I served on one of the task forces of the Ferguson Commission. My task force focused specifically on racial profiling, excessive force, and mass demonstrations. And it was interesting because that my task force had on it the then president of the Fraternal Order of Police. There was the former chief of police of St. Louis and the public safety director for the state. There were scholars, other community members, people from the Anti-Defamation League. So it was really a true bringing together, like we are around this table, of people with different experiences, different perspectives, different backgrounds to come together and try to figure out, not just identify the problem, but to move beyond that and then begin to really talk about some real solutions to some of those challenges. And I'll share with you all this painting later and read the, this was one of the things I got as a sign of gratitude for being on the, a part of the commission. But so a couple of things that I'll point out. One, I will tell you all, as a communication scholar, it's no surprise that I would say communication is key. And in most instances, whether they're successful shows of dialogue or unsuccessful, there's a breakdown of communication in the unsuccessful ones, and you can identify where communication worked and was effective in those that are successful. So communication is always critically important. The second one is the idea and the definition of ignorance. So now the professor of me is going to come out and I'm going to ask you all a question. I'm giving you a chance here. I'm letting you know in advance. What's the definition of ignorance? Yeah, it's literally the right one. So when people say ignorance in its truest sense, it's the idea of lacking knowledge, right, lacking comprehension. And so I would say to you all that one of the things that we have to do is become more honest about the fact that we're all ignorant. We are all ignorant to some extent, in some way. It takes a certain level of vulnerability and openness to admit your ignorance, and then we must desire to be less ignorant. As it pertains to topics such as this. Then the other is, I would say, we have to be careful of what I often call the illusion of inclusion. So in our environment, we talk about inclusive excellence. And one of the things that we should always challenge ourselves to do is make sure that we're not putting on a facade of inclusiveness. But because that's the illusion, right? It's the look over here at my left hand and really something else is going on with the right. And so we have to be very mindful of that, and hopefully we'll talk more about that later. And then the last thing that I will offer before transitioning, I guess, to Dean Bruce, who's next, I've given you plenty of time to figure out what you're talking about, is the other reason this is so important is as I look around the room and I think about what I know of some of you all and what your interests are when you leave this place, whether it be education, whether you're going to a science field, whether you're going into criminal justice, it matters not. If you think about the fact that you all have to be very adept at understanding the different people's lenses, right? The way people see the world, right? And how depending on the lenses, right? Depending on the glasses you're wearing, depending on the prescription of those glasses, you see the world differently as a result of that. And you're going to be working with people who have a myriad experiences as they come to you in your classrooms, for example. And you have to figure out how to interact and engage and be respectful of those students and their experiences, even if yours are different and completely, drastically something that you're ignorant about. So I'm really glad that you all are here for that reason as well.
Well, following the president is always an honor and a privilege.
I feel like he didn't mean it like that.
And always an honor and a privilege, and who could ever knock that? But I will talk a little bit about my experience and then give my initial thoughts and then pass it along. As it relates to having conversations and being in dialogue, I did go through some training in my last position. I was the dean of students, but we did engage in dialogue on our campus, and we had a whole dialogue project that was funded by the Women Foundation. I'm excited to be at Eureka and to be in a place where we're beginning to have these conversations here. It's very, very, very important. And I will add to what the president said about the importance of this as part of your educational journey. If we don't give you an opportunity to explore how power and privilege operates in our society and how that impacts different people in society, then we have failed you. As institutions of higher education. Actually, we are perpetuating oppression if we aren't allowing, or aren't making sure that our students at least are touched by that conversation. So I think it's important, vitally important. As a scholar, my master's thesis was on the experience of first-generation college students. My dissertation was on the experience of preaching or faculty of color, and I actually wrote in my discussion section of my dissertation to provosts and presidents and explained to them ways that they could retain faculty of color on their campuses and not just people of color in general, but if you want to retain your black faculty, this is what you should do. If you want to retain your Latino faculty, this is what you should do. So I broke it down a little bit. I also had an opportunity to teach, I've taught graduate students, and have studied race and diversity in higher education in general. Over the course of my career, I taught a course on social movements and activism in higher education, where we studied social movements on college campuses. And I think that's there's an interesting intersection, actually, to the conversation we're having today and what social movements are happening and how college students are organizing around issues on campus that are impacting their lives. So we could dive into that a little bit if you want to as well. I went to the play. I thought that it was really well done, actually very impactful. I did feel like there needed to be a follow-up conversation. At the end, it just kind of ended, and everybody was just kind of like, there was actually a feeling in the theater. Did you all feel that were there? There was a feeling in the theater like, wow. But nobody knew what to say, and everybody just kind of like anxious look that you look around. I'm glad that we're having this conversation. The person that I sat next to said, "Wow, there was trigger. That was a trigger. there were tons of triggers in that. I think that there needs to be processing that's done by people of color, and there needs to be understanding what the triggers were and why they were triggers for people who aren't people of color in that space. I'm hoping that we can have an open dialogue about the way that the different ways that people perceived and viewed the play. Right, because your social identity as your race, your racial identity impacted the way that you viewed the show, 100%. And I think that your gender probably did as well. I think that it would be interesting to see those perspectives and discuss why those perspectives exist. And I love this topic, by the way. We were just having this conversation in my office. We have our inclusive excellence working group, but it's a couple of people were in here. And we were having an interesting conversation about to eradicate or not to eradicate racism was our discussion. And I said, I'm really actually not that worried about eradicating racism.
He was trying to keep my feet on the ground.
And
everybody was like, and I was like, I just want to be able to have a conversation with the people in the room. I'm very comfortable having conversations about race. I have conversations about race every single day, mostly in my head, but I do all the time. But there are a lot of people who aren't comfortable in that space, and we need to be more comfortable. We need everybody to be more comfortable in that space. That's where we should start.
Yeah, where we can open up.
Thank you. Stuff to follow up. There's two open statements. I had a little bit of time to think, though.
Yeah,
that's good. Thanks to all of you for being here. It's important in a college community that we come together and have these kinds of conversations, even the ones that are difficult to have. For those of you who don't know me or know my background, I am a historian. My area of specialization is African American history. And here at Eureka, every 2 years, I teach a course in African American. It's coming up next year, fall semester. So those of you who are scheduling, it's a commercial. Those of you who are scheduling might want to consider taking that course. In addition to that, I also teach a course that comes up once every 4 years, which is a Sub-Saharan Africa course. And that course is also going to be coming up next year in the spring. So if you're interested in learning about Sub-Saharan Africa, that's a possibility that you can do. I'm also teaching a special topics course next year. It's going to be a gen ed class, which is a comparative history of slavery in the Atlantic world. And it's going to be comparing slavery experiences in Brazil, in the Caribbean, and in the American South. And I've never taught, I've never taught that course before, but I've been thinking about it for a long time. In fact, when I first came up with the concept, one of the ideas that I thought would be really cool would be somehow visiting those three locations during the semester. Well, we won't be able to do that.
I was going to come along.
but that course also, I think, sort of this spring course next year. And one other course that I want to mention, I had an opportunity with Dr. Wright, I guess it was 4 years ago?
It was fall of 2015.
Okay, so about 3 years ago, we team taught a sociology class, which is the minority peoples class. And it was an amazing experience to work together, and I think we had some good teamwork.
I think we did. I know we did. It was great. The communication, culture, the historian, and a course that was created by the sociologist. We came together. It was a great class, actually. So,
now, as a historian, if I had to sort of pinpoint precisely what it is that's my area of specialization, I would say it's the history of resistance. I wrote a dissertation many years ago that deals with the issue of slave insurrection, slave conspiracy, and I wouldn't call myself a communication scholar, but one of the things that we really looked at was how violence itself, or the threat of violence, is a kind of language all its own. And kind of intricate dance that goes on in terms of how folks will use power on both sides of the equation to try to affect some type of result that they're seeking. And one of the things that you'll find out, we may get into this in our discussion tonight, one of the ways that you define yourself as a person is by your ability to say no. If you've ever really thought about that. You know, many of you in here might say, you know, I'm a yes person. I'm a yes person. I just sort of, let's go along with the crowd, and you know, let's basically, you know, let's just go with the flow. But the problem is, if you're always just a yes person, you risk the possibility of making yourself invisible. Or, excuse me, I said the wrong word, invisible. You risk making yourself invisible to the sense that you don't stand out as the unique individual. But when you find that ability to say no, and when you speak your truth and say no, you're drawing out the parameters of your own life. You're basically saying, this is what I will tolerate, this is what I won't tolerate. And I think we saw a lot of evidence of that in the 10-minute play last week. And if you think about it, within 10 minutes you saw the story of three individuals who lost their lives. And at many, many levels, it was a kind of sensory experience. You know, the first story that you heard was a shot being heard and the person died. So, a sense of sound. And the other, it was a visual kind of experience. She witnessed the death of a close friend. And then the final death was her own death, in which you sort of get the intense feeling. You know, there was no sense of smelling or tasting death, but if you are around that kind of environment, it sort of envelops you. And so it was a total sensory kind of immersion. And so when you live in that kind of world in which you never quite know when your time is going to be up, but you assume that your time is going to be up, how you navigate the saying the yes and the no is really going to be important. How much of yourself, how much of your persona you're willing to give up is going to matter. One of the lines that really moved me was when the main character said, I still had to be compliant enough to stay alive. What she's talking about there is navigating the yes and the no. How much of myself am I willing to be, and how much of what society expects me to be am I willing to be? And so these are the kinds of conversations that I think the play presents But these are real life decisions that folks make every single day. You know, how do you be your truest self?
I mean, there's some powerful phrases that I picked out from that. PTSD. And I wrote down generational trauma. Facade of inclusion. Drawing out the parameters of your life. Perpetuating oppression. Triggers for people of color. I mean, those are powerful phrases that communicate very, very well. Just what is at stake, right, in the conversation. Just a little bit of it. All right, so I've got some questions here. First, I'm going to start from an individual kind of orientation. What do you think is the best thing students at Eureka College can do to combat racism, either on campus or in general? So this is from what can an individual do? Because the follow-up question is, how can student organizations start the conversation with marginalized groups on campus? Or of marginalized groups on campus? So if you could kind of, if there's a difference in your mind between an individual strategy and a kind of group organization strategy?
Well, let me start here. So should we start by defining what racism is? Because to make sure that we're on the same page as of what that means, and then we'll get into the question, but I think we should start by defining what racism is. So what's racism?
I would say discriminatory practices defined by skin color.
Okay. That's part of it.
It can sometimes go deeper than skin color, though. Any type of differences in heritage or ethnicity, it just sort of reaches different boundaries.
What is the difference between prejudice and racism?
Prejudice, I think of as like judging someone before you know everything about them. So making like a snap decision just based on what you can see, not what you fully understand.
Okay. As opposed to racism being so this is important because for us to even unpack what this question that was asked, we have to understand what racism is, right?
Maybe racism is like prejudice, but you know the person, you understand the person, you still hold true to those negative beliefs.
Could it be like having a specific idea about who the people like more broad?
Part of it. Racism.
Go ahead.
You know, no. Racism is about oppression, right? So if we go back to defining what oppression happens, is exhibited when someone has power and privilege over somebody for a particular reason, right? So racism as a function of oppression is when someone has power and privilege over somebody based on their racial category. Right? Fair?
Fair. Well, it generally involves some type of action.
Yeah, that's
right. You know, when I think about prejudice is a kind of illogical assumption that folks will make about a particular group. And my I think there's a lot of people in the world who probably share some type of prejudice that's out there, like the logical assumptions that people make. But racism is usually when you get to the point where you see some kind of overt action taking place. Now keep in mind there's a wide range of the kind of action. It could be a hurtful statement, or it could be something that's, you know, physically violent. But I think the question then becomes, especially in a college community, what should be the response when racism presents itself? You know, how should we respond? Either as an individual or as a collective community.
So the answer to the question becomes, whenever you see it, responding to it, right? Is that?
Well, as an individual, what do you do? And part of my answer, I guess, and I'll let you all pick up on this, is, and it's just too bad that none of you all took a class with the two of us. Because, you know, because you can see over, I think one of the things that, if I dare say, that we did really well, that you took the lead on, is really walking students through historically all the different times from internment camps and all those different moments in our history, our country's history, where you see some of the remnants of these things. However, to the question though, individually, I think number one is to what Dr. Rodriguez said about everyone possessing some type of prejudice, understanding that we all have biases. So individually, we have to understand and recognize kind of my point about ignorance even, right? There are a lot of things that people don't know, but we all have certain biases. And I think we also have to individually, another thing that we can all do is to be very careful of these things called microaggressions. And I
should have played it.
No, I should just have Jess Brown talk about microaggressions. Oh. But there's this concept called microaggressions, and we'll talk more about that. But I think all of us, because of our biases, because they're inherent, because we walk around with certain power and privilege, each and every one of us in this room, we're all privileged in a way because we're part of the educational elite. Each and every one of you all, just by being in college right now, you're all part of the educational elite. So you may not realize it. You're like, well, I'm not. You are. You're a part of the educational elite. Want to, not accept it, not accept it. You absolutely are. And I'll tell you that some people will tell you and call you on your elitism. You've been up there at that college and now you come back with this and that. They call you out on your elitist behavior, your elitist attitudes. So I would say check yourself. Individually check yourself. Individually be honest with you, if no one else. Be honest about those biases that you have. Interrogate and question and challenge yourself and try and figure out, what are my blind spots? We all have them. What are my blind spots, right? Is it religion, right? Is it the fact that I am so deeply rooted and attached to Christianity that I don't understand that Christmas is a Christian holiday? That for people who are Muslim, right, people who are Jewish, right, they don't have holidays off, right? We're not closed for other people's holidays. We're closed for the Christian holidays. Right? Think about those kinds of things too, right? So if you're a Christian around this table, you happen to carry with you a certain level of privilege. And there are others within the religious context who are marginalized in that context as well. So I think really checking ourselves on all of those areas and ways in which we might be able to then move to what has always been the most explosive, most challenging conversation, which then is race. And so how do you get to that point? Well, you get to that point individually by thinking about your own privilege, by thinking about the ways in which your beliefs are normalized. What of your beliefs are the norm, right? Like Christianity being the norm. And so that's individually what I would say is very important. And then collectively, I think my answer is different, and I would like to take that separate. So.
The only other thing I would say is that, in terms of addressing it from an individual perspective, whenever somebody says something that's inappropriate, we always have a choice. We have a choice to either speak up or to not. And so, you all know when someone says something racist, right? And so, whether you decide to say something or you decide to be quiet, or just sit back and not say anything, it definitely impacts that situation. Because we had this conversation with the RAs a couple of weeks ago, but sometimes all you have to do is just say, hey, that went right, and that ends it. But if you sit back and are quiet, it might just perpetuate this, it will just keep going, right, and perpetuated. And all you would have had to say was, hey, that ain't cool. And that could have ended it, could end it. So that's just simple, right?
Can I say, J-Rob, before you jump in, don't lose your train of thought, but can I remind you all, too, that anything that's said that is considered to be racist is everybody's problem in this room. Anything that's homophobic is everybody's problem in this room. Anything that's sexist is everybody's problem in this room, right? Just because you feel like, well, that's not my, I'm not black, or I'm not a woman, or I'm not, you know, gay. No, it's still your issue, right? It's still yours to address. You don't get to moonwalk out of it and give yourself that justification that it's not about you. And that's at a very individual level, right? Because oftentimes people say, well, that's not my fight. It absolutely is yours, right? It's every single person's fight. So I just wanted to.
I think in an educational community, we always need to remember that there are teachable moments that we experience every single day. And when something is stated or something is done that is inappropriate, to challenge that, to say no to that, is a way that you identify your position, you take your stand. And by saying no to it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to take a swing or anything, but you're trying to make whoever it is that said or did something realize their error, realize why they're wrong. Sometimes that might work best in a one-on-one setting, because a lot of times if you use that to try to sort of create a scene, things might escalate, things might get worse. But if you try to take upon yourself to say, I think you need to see things differently, see things from a different perspective, you are providing an educational experience that might be able to change that other person.
I would add to your statement about this needs to be an own, thing. This is our community. We have responsibility for this, all of us. In those moments, even if it doesn't directly relate to you, doesn't mean you're outside of responsibility for being responsive to that. And because probably being the most privileged, arguably, that's the fallback, right? Because I'm normative, I can exit from those conversations easily. Because they're almost never about me. So, and the flip side of that is, if you really want to combat racism, then the heavy lifting of combating racism needs to fall on white people. That's, well, let's leave it at that.
Right, you need to totally let that sit there.
Oh, there's hands up now.
Right, sorry, you did this, you created a way.
Yeah, I would like to say something. You know, I think to combat racism, the first thing we all need to know is where did it come from? Why does it exist? You know, I have a theory, but I'm not gonna lay it on y'all right now. But you know, it's because I hear you, Chaplain Bruce, but from what I've learned and the knowledge that I've gained through the years, it teaches me the opposite, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm sorry, you know, but what it teaches me is, it's really on the shoulders of both, mm-hmm. But I know you're saying that it's on the shoulders of white people now because of everything that's happening, but if we go before that, we will ask ourselves, well, how do we get to this point? You know, like the why. And if we read and do research and say, well, okay, well, you know, the first human on earth was an African. We found the bones and it was an African. So that would tell you something. At some point in time, the Africans did something to lighter skinned people that angered them to get to where we are now. And what they're doing is, like with anybody, if you abuse somebody for so long, they're gonna react, you know. So we're getting the reaction of the abuse of the original man, right? So we're getting the backlash for that. You know, I'm mad at you because of what you did, you know. And so we have what we have now. We're giving it labels, racism, this, that, and the other, you know. But I think that we should all research and find out where it all started from, you know. And so just a briefing, that's okay. But
that's okay.
Yeah.
So, but what you said, there's value in what you said. This whole conception of race is socially constructed, right? And who has power, who doesn't have power based on race, has been socially constructed over time, so that most of us don't even understand where it came from. We just know that there's a social. And that we're taught to fit into our roles based on what happens in the media, based on what our parents tell us, based on what our churches tell us, based on what, and all of that stuff comes from somewhere, right? That's what you're getting. Where did this come from? But it came from a social construction. At some point, someone said, "White is right," and then everybody else falls into a. Someplace underneath that, so.
You know, there's, you know, if you take an issue like slavery, you can make an argument that slavery existed from the dawn of civilization, but you know, early societies practiced it. But what was curious is that racism was invented later. And there's actually some scholars who have tried to figure out when it is that racism originates. And the general consensus on this is it's about the 10th or 11th century. And what you have is Western Europeans sort of taking a look at what they know of the world. They're aware that there are people who are Muslim, and there's a lot of them. And they consider them to be a large warrior society. And they've heard of China, and they know that China is advanced in terms of its technology, and that there's a lot of them, and that Western Christian Europeans, more or less decide, we're sort of outnumbered. There's these other groups that are out there that are larger than us, more powerful than us, more technologically superior than us, and you know how we're going to beat them? We're better than them. It's a kind of sort of building up of self, saying that what we have is so unique and so powerful that, you know, our medicine is more powerful than any that they're going to have. And it's an idea that really is born maybe 1,000 or so years ago. But prior to that, you don't really find a whole lot of evidence of racism.
You find it, you know, it just wasn't labeled as racist.
Right.
You know,
right.
But, you know, like what happened was you had Africans who had the ability to have non-melanated babies, and they didn't understand what was going on. They didn't have the science to understand what was happening, but these babies were being born, these children were being born without melanin, with white skin. They felt it was a curse. Our babies are being cursed. We don't like them. So they were killing them, doing everything they could to them. So the mothers love children regardless of what's wrong with them, anything, whatever, they love them. So they took them away from the fathers because they were being killed, they were being murdered. They took these children up in the mountains. The children came after a while, over years, they became accustomed to the mountains, the cold. They got upset. They came back down with the vengeance because they felt they were being ostracized. They were kicked out, so they came down with the vengeance, you know, and they learned how to conquer. You conquer through divide. You divide and you conquer. And they realized one thing, there were more people of color, regardless of where they come from, there were more people of color than there were white people. So we need to figure out how to conquer the people of color. I don't care if they're white, yellow, brown, tan, we need to conquer them because we are the minority, you know? And through the years, it changed.
But that's the point of that same notion of there's fewer of you.
Right.
So, but that's how today we have this, even now, right, where people talk about what the majority will look like in 2020. Now we're knocking on the door 2020, right, in terms of racial and ethnic minorities and numbers. But this is where you get people who talk about, it's not about numbers, right? It's not about numbers at all. It's actually about power, right? And power is never given. Power is only taken. Nobody's gonna say, oh, now there's more of you than there are of us. So here, now you're in power. No, power is taken. It's never just given over. And so it's really a power thing. And once you make it that, and once you're able to figure out where you can figure out the divisions and get people to, right, infight, then you're able to maintain that level of power. But Chaplain Bruce or Megan had her hand up.
So I guess I like just want to make a comment and then have someone maybe respond to it if possible. I think from what I've seen on this campus, when we're trying to educate people, especially with Black people, when they see a comment, they hear a comment, they react. Obviously, they're upset. So instead of like taking a step back and like, talking to the person, they instead yell at them or like, now I'm never speaking to you again. Like I'm gonna go gossip about it, like just because we're on a college campus. Instead of hey, like come here for a second. I just want to let you know that this was wrong and this is why I feel upset about it. You know what I mean? So I think that kind of, not that it brings us like a step back, but I mean in my head it does. And that might be a controversial topic, but I don't know what else to say about it.
So when you get that reaction, I mean, I'm not saying it's right. I try not to do it. Mm-hmm. But when you say something that you don't think is appropriate, I don't understand why certain people expect not to get the reaction that they're looking for. Because initially, that's what you're looking for. You're looking for that reaction. You're looking for a reason to say, oh, I was right about it. You know? So, I don't know.
Well, you know, so let me say this. Let me just offer this as more kind of potential controversial fodder, which is, and I'll go back to what Dr. Ali, so Rita Ali was our speaker, our MLK program speaker. Some of you were there, some weren't. So for the benefit of those of you who weren't there, a similar question was asked about the kind of what can we do? What individually can people do to really affect positive change? And at the root of her answer, and the two of you are there as well, and Chaplain Bruce, but at the root of her answer, one of the very first things she said was to not assume malice. Right? She said, don't assume malice. So I actually think, Michaela, really honestly, that, and that's why I wanted to bring up the whole notion of ignorance.
Yeah.
I honestly, truly believe that there is a deep, deep level of ignorance that exists. And it's true, I gotta say, in its truest sense, that some people take it as a derogatory term, and it's not to be one in this sense. It's just that literally people are ignorant. So, and think of it, ignorant in terms of maybe the way you grew up, where you grew up, right? How you grew up, maybe there was other ignorance, and maybe there was something that went beyond ignorance. Maybe you grew up around kind of racist behavior. I mean, so there's a number of things that I think are at play. And sometimes, now I can't speak to all the times, and I don't know specific examples
right.
either.
Right.
However, I will tell you that I think genuinely there's a deep level of ignorance that exists. And as a result of that, you get comments, and sometimes, and the reaction, I think, is because if the belief is that it's malice, like that's a malicious comment, then you are instinctively going to react in a particular way. So the question then becomes, how do you really respond effectively to ignorance, right? And to then, so then, if another a comment is made or the same comment is made, now you can say that.
Right.
Now you can say, okay, now, didn't we, I feel like we talked about this before. Didn't we have this conversation before? And now I know it might be coming from a disrespectful place, a genuinely disrespectful place.
I think that, and then you have to ask this question, when it comes out your mouth, like you said with ignorance, do you feel uncomfortable asking the question? Like what they ask you or whatever they may say that they might feel uncomfortable saying, you know, I think that
they probably don't.
Right.
I talked about microaggressions. Great opportunity to say what that is, right? So these microaggressions feels like death by a thousand cuts. Right? A gentleman who came to campus last semester described it in a similar way. Mark Orby from Western Michigan. Talks about it in that context. And so, for example, how often do people approach you and touch your hair? They touch, right? How often do you get that near close thing where you're like, oh my God, are you about to, please tell me you're not about to touch my hair, right? All the time, right? That's a microaggression. That's something that is very offensive. Right, to do, to just go up and touch a black woman's hair because you're intrigued by her braids or whatever it is. But that comes from a place of ignorance, right? It doesn't come from a place of disrespect. It comes from a genuine place of, oh my goodness. And the question is, how do you get your hair to do that?
Right. And I'll be ignorant right now. Like, I would have never thought about that. But oh, your hair is beautiful. Like, let me touch it. You know
right.
what I mean?
And
I never
right.
thought about it like that.
Right.
And that's where relationships come in.
That's
it's not willing,
right.
we're not willing to have sustained, committed relationships with one another. We're not going to get beyond the surface level.
But there's another side to that. I think that Jess
yes.
is going to talk a little bit about
you know,
that.
I agree with the ignorant comment, Dr. Mm-hmm. Wright. But there's this other piece called racial battle fatigue,
sure.
where
oh, yeah.
there's these times that you know people want us as in black folks, because I can only speak to the black folks because I'm not a Latino person or any other person of color, but it is tiring, and you're tired when the umpteen thousand person comes to you and wants to ask you about a question. I just say, here's a book. Go read a book, go look at some literature, because it is tiring to walk around in an all white space and people come up to you and want to ask particular questions. So some of those responses are from, we are tired of answering questions that are, to us, seem very simple, duh, you know, type of questions, and dealing with ignorance on a daily basis. So it's like, I gotta do my job, I gotta somewhat smile and do my job, and then I also have to answer these very ignorant questions that come at me daily, all the time. In the grocery store, at the mall, you know, it's tiring. So some of that anger that you may experience from people of color is because they're tired.
But this is too where I go back to Chapman Bruce's comment about who bears the burden. So this is, I think, what the spirit of his comment was about the fact that at some point, right, people who look like him, people who look like, right, have to take on some of the responsibility as well. And so no fight in the history of the country really has been won with people who all look the same. And so I think that's very important, right? So the burden, some of that burden is gonna have to be taken up. Now, but to that point, man could be sitting there thinking, well, I want to, but I'm gonna need a little help,
sure.
Right? I'm gonna need a little education myself. If you want me to be a person who's a champion and an ally, I'm all in for that, but there are things that I don't know.
Right.
So that's where I'm saying it's a tricky balance, because I get the fatigue. I feel it, absolutely. So, but at the same time, you gotta be mindful of, again, who are the people who are trying to be your allies too? Because they might be coming to you for a different reason so that they can be the ones to kind of help, to support, and to beat back some of the ignorance that they're hearing that you don't even hear, right? That they're hearing in their circles that doesn't even get to us or to your ears. And so I think, so that's where you gotta kind of also be able to balance those things out as well.
It's a negotiation.
Yeah, it's that no thing, but you know, the piece that I think Dr. Rodriguez opened with in his statement initially, too. So.
And everybody's different. I mean, sorry, I'm not a parent, but everybody's different. I think everybody has a vocation, everybody has a personality, everybody has a leadership style. We talk about leadership styles all the time. When I was in seminary, they talked about it in these terms. When you decide what kind of ministry you're going to be. Are you going to be a prophetic ministry? Where you're going to be out front and you're going to be, there are going to be people aiming for you because you're saying truth to people that don't want to hear it. That's the prophetic ministry. Or the pastoral ministry, where you're bringing people and caring for them after the world is treating them badly. Or the priestly function, where you are celebrating, or you're marrying, and you're all of these different roles, ceremonial roles. The point was that it needs to match who you feel called to be and your gifts. And there are some people who just naturally have a way of defusing conflicted relationships. And that's a gift. And so they can walk into a conflicted relationship and they can listen and they can help each side understand the other. So that's all to say, you need to be honest about who you are, who you feel like, what your vocation is. You know, not everybody is a healer. Some people need to beat a loud drum. That's who they are. They're going to be beating a loud drum. And or they're what they used to call in the seminary, they were the tip of the plow. They're gonna turn everything upside down. And then the people who come after them are sowers. But no one likes to be turned upside down. But you gotta have those prophetic voices, you know. So if you need to treat the other person as an individual, not as kind of a representative of a group, so they can be themselves. And you have to take it as personal. If they react in a certain way, that might be an opportunity for you to learn something new, or just to be a friend and listen.
Let me just define, so microaggressions, just for everybody's purposes, FYI, from my perspective, are these unintended, often unknown types of comments. It could be verbal kinds of comments or actions, things that happen that people inflict on you that are offensive, right? To people of color or to women or, you know, to any kind of group that is not necessarily the majority group. And let me give you all, I mean, how many of you all in this room are exceedingly wealthy? Okay, none. So look, some of you all might come from, you might, rich with love, and right, rich with love and joy. But one of the examples that's, and I think from, there's always the idea that I want you all's mind to be opened up to all different types of difference. So not just race, but understand the broad nature of difference, including just a difference of perspective generally, right, even about race. So. Broad nature. So let's talk about socioeconomic status. How often do you hear things where, even at Eureka College, where we come up with something, so for example, I'll give you a great example. So Student Senate is talking about the possibility of expanding Senior Week, right? And if, and upon expanding Senior Week, it might require some additional fees, right? So the conversation, so what's the assumption there? What's the assumption? Everybody could pay for that. So the comment people can make is, oh, it's only, right? It's only another $50. It's only another $100. Well, for how many of you all in this room is only another $50 or $100? You don't even have to say I identify. But that's a big deal, right? To tell me I only have to pay another, right? So that's kind of like, well, that's kind of offensive. Now, you don't say anything. You don't want to sit there and be like, well, I'm poor. I can't come up with another $100. But think of how quickly we say that. The people saying it, they're not saying it in a mean way. It's literally from a different place, right? Microaggressions are things like that, and especially you hear them in a racial context, a racialized context, a gender context, right? I can't tell you how many people have told me, not that I give a good speech, or not that, man, you're a good speaker. I accept that one. I'm like, thank you, that's great. But when you tell me that I speak well, right? You speak well. So then what I want to ask is, so did you want me to speak in clicks? Did you think I was going to speak in clicks? How did you think I would speak? Did you think I would say speaking a language or a form that you wouldn't understand, right? That's offensive. That's a microaggression, right? Now, they didn't mean it. They thought it was what?
A compliment.
A compliment. But from my perspective, through my lens, so I talk about experiential lenses, through my lens, it's not a compliment. Right, because I'm a well-educated human being and a grown person. So how, right, what was the expectation? So what must your expectation have been of me if you consider that to be noteworthy to say as a compliment, right?
I would add to the, in that conversation that we had, just add, because I think it's important that we gain understanding, right? So you were talking about how people of color sometimes get offended whenever you ask them questions and so forth, and then it just shuts down the conversation. I would ask you, now that you know why people sometimes get offended, that you don't shut down. Right. And just say, you know what, it's too much for them right now. I'm not going to put up. Because that's the other part of the understanding, right? Because sometimes, or oftentimes what will happen is that white people will just be like, well, I'm not, and I'm not going to, just understanding that sometimes people of color are experiencing racial fatigue and just can't deal with it right now. Now, again, we should assume, but sometimes that's going to happen.
Yeah.
And when it does, you need to understand that perspective as well, I guess is what I was saying.
Mm-hmm. And I think that kind of battle fatigue that's been described is something that if you just continue to sort of accumulate all of this through microaggressions, there runs the risk. You sort of lose part of yourself, but I think you can also compartmentalize yourself. And I'll try to tie this into the play a little bit. I was fascinated by the concept of how the body was differentiated from what I would call the soul or the spirit. That it begins by saying, look at this black body, look at this silhouette of a body. And it even uses the expression, this something. One of the worst possible things that can happen is when you allow yourself to be objectified. When you quit becoming a person and you allow yourself to become a thing. And in the play, I think there was an interesting kind of dualism that existed, where the body was a thing, but the soul or the spirit was what Chandler was saying. You were hearing her speak from her soul. And it was almost this out-of-body kind of experience. And I think that's what, you know, this accumulation of microaggressions, if you allow it to run its course, it has this potential where it can sort of turn you into something that you're not. It can turn you, not human. In other words, you sort of create this, you know, selfish thing but then there's still sort of the fighting spirit that exists within you that's separate from, you know, the object.
And Riley, how did you feel in your role in the play? I'm curious, whatever you feel comfortable sharing.
You say, like, what you thought about before, like, what you were nervous about.
I guess I was, like, nervous about people who didn't know me. Mm-hmm. If I was too convincing, they'd be like, oh, she's racist, that was too easy for her, she was too convincing. But if I'm not convincing enough, then the show isn't as good as it could be. Mm-hmm. And I remember when Michaela first messaged me asking if I would play the role of the police officer, I was thinking, I really want to work with Michaela, mm-hmm. but I'm also nervous that, you know, what if it does come off wrong? Or what if I do it and, like, not well? What if I don't live up to it? And then, you know, it falls flat. But it wasn't that hard to make a decision because I like working with my kids.
Did you still feel, did you all feel that that silence, the deafening silence at the end at all from wherever your perspective was at the end of the play? Well, at the end, so the play's over, what was that immediate thought as you were looking out at the audience or listening to what was from when we went? Junius was there when I was there. I know the two of you all was there, Jacob and Travis, you are. So, yeah, but you are. So several of us were there at the same time and in close proximity. So for me, it was a deafening silence.
I thought
it was the next night too. Whenever we were there, the same thing happened.
Yeah.
I was proud because I felt like people were like, "Do we clap here?"
Really? Right.
What's the right response?
It was some silence until the people started clapping. I was like, okay, you know, I was really proud of everyone because they really worked hard, especially, you know, Riley and Kiara and everything. Riley, like, we were rehearsing. Oh my gosh! When she told her to shut up talking, I was like, Riley, like, this was like, you know,
truly
she
embodied,
really embodied it, yeah.
Right. And even her responses that were very short, I was in fear of my life. She went for the gun. It was very, so the whole PTSD piece where a student, you know, commented about that, that's where that comes from, right? I mean, because it was such kind of a real thing that is right there in front of you at any point in time. And you talked about Chandler talking about that throughout the entire play and having this kind of out-of-body experience throughout. That's a really good way of describing it. So.
I thought it was very triggering in a good way because people got to see it again, but triggering in a way because that is very... it was personal, being a black woman. I think I actually texted the actor and told her that she reminded me of a black scholar as she, you know, as she was laying there and acting and everything. But with the situation that happened with Sandra Bland's murder, it was very triggering, the whole scenario. So I also said the writer should be proud because you all executed some of the smallest details in a way that I don't think anyone but a woman of color would have been able to do. So I really appreciated how you all kind of almost brought honor in a way to several women, but in particularly for me it was Sandra, and then, you know, so it was good.
Did any others who went to the play want to talk about your thoughts? And you don't have to.
I just
wonder. Can you turn the camera on yourself now?
No. I can hide behind it. I'm just going to hide behind it. I'm not important. I'm just the camera person. So I was backstage, and I hadn't actually seen the show yet or really paid any attention to their performances, like their practices and everything. So I'm just backstage, and I'm, you know, listening. And I can sort of see through the curtain. And when it was over, I was kind of like, is it over? Or, because it was just really, all of a sudden, really quiet. And I was like, are people still breathing? Like, what's up? And it kind of, like, just the intensity in the air, like, made my hair stand up. It was really, really amazing.
I thought it was really interesting because it goes to a deep part of you, and it's not sugar-coated, it is very real. And in my experience, it brought to what I see on the news a lot to life, and it made it less, oh, it's another thing that happened, to, okay, this is what it's like from my perspective in reality, which is something I haven't experienced, but now it gives me a little bit of a deeper understanding of that.
Okay. To be in that moment, because it, you know, a play is very good when it literally invites you in, right? When you're invited in, literally, so you're not just kind of sitting there, but you are in the moment. So you almost feel as though there's something you should be doing, even as you know it's unfolding, you know, because you know what's going to happen. So part of your brain is saying, interject, you know, do something, because now you're in that moment. So versus seeing it after it's happened on the news, you know, whatever the case may be, to actually be in that moment is a different thing. And so you all did a great job of inviting the audience in to what was actually taking place and what would be the end and the outcome of that, I thought. And so that made it more intense, right? That made that feeling of that intensity being in the room. Which I thought then, I'm so glad we're having a discussion and allowing people to process this for whatever they'd like to say or whatever we might be able to say to put some additional context around what a masterful job of doing with the play. So. Is there I know the time is getting late on, I'm gonna ask one more question. And I do wanna go back to the what can organizations do question if we wanna use that as part of our community. So,
I think from my understanding of these questions, it seems like a lot of them have been, or all of them have been addressed in some way. But if you wanted to specifically talk about organizations, that would be great. I think one of the definitions that I would throw out there, too, implied in all of this, too, is that there's institutional racism. So that it doesn't necessarily have to be the act of one person. It can be a policy or a law
procedures.
It can be, this is our tradition. This is how, I mean, it can be hidden in so many different ways. And it's then it self-perpetuates. So we have to, as an institution, always be wary of institutionalized racism that is not always easy to see. Some of it's very blatant, you know, like redlining in real estate. That was just blatant, and it was a blatant racist kind of law or practice. But there are kind of, I guess you might call them micro-aggressive tendencies for institutions. I'm working on this for Founders Day,
by the way. Thank you. This is helpful.
So,
Chaplain Rubes will be our Founders Day convocation speaker. Very fitting for those of you who don't know. We normally bring someone in from the outside, whether it be an alum or otherwise. And this year, as he and I were talking about the planning of the event, thought and we wanted to be disruptive, as I've been talking about positive disruptive change across campus. And to get more people involved, thought that who better to help us on that path than our very own Chaplain Bruce. So I'm really glad that he's going to be the speaker for that. I guess I would wrap in part and talk about, again, just thank you all for being here. And from an organizational perspective, I think the more you all can collectively work together and reach out to other organizations, the better. I think some of the best events that I can recall across all the institutions where I've been has been collaborative efforts that have occurred with organizations where people might say, oh my gosh, they're working together, right? Oh, that's something, right? So branch out, be willing, because that too, think of all the things that have to happen in the planning process for any event to occur that we have on campus. Right, think of all the meetings, think of all the discussions and all of that. And that helps with the relationship piece. That helps you to really get to know and understand what people's motives might be. if there is an instance where they're saying something out of ignorance. And so allowing those opportunities for your organizations to partner with others and unite around a common purpose is, I think, one of the best possible pieces of advice I could offer from a student organization perspective. And the second piece of advice is do something different. We're talking about positive disruptive change at every other level of the institution, and I would challenge you all as student clubs and organization leaders and students to also think of some disruptive, positively disruptive changes that you can do. So don't just do the same events. Challenge yourself, push yourself, get outside of your comfort zone. Be uncomfortable. Do something and say, you know, we think this is something of great value and we want to, let's see what resources around campus we can consult to pull this off in a respectful manner and have some kind of outcomes that everyone can probably appreciate and rally around. So definitely push yourselves out of your boundaries of different events and opportunities and those kinds of things. So I would give definitely those two pieces of advice and one last example. Who's a senior in here? Was it just seniors in here or juniors and seniors? How many of you all were here when we used to do the torchlight ceremony for homecoming? Just the seniors,
yeah,
right? That was such a controversial change that occurred, because you talk about a long-standing tradition at Eureka College, yeah, where they did a torchlight ceremony. Jacob's face. Do you want to talk about that, Jacob? What's that facial expression?
That brings some images.
Yeah.
It seems mortifying to.
When you.
It's literally the best part of homecoming.
Right.
I think. Like, bring us together as a community. Like, you had to be there. Like, I don't know.
Well, and so that's the, so there's that, those perspectives, right? Right, those are perspectives, right? So that's where different perspectives, and you have to try to understand what those perspectives are. But for many of us, the seeing the visual of that, literally seeing a whole street full of people with torches walking down the street.
WTH.
And the first year that I was here, I'll tell you, Telly was there, Jess was there. We all went, and I had already expressed some serious concerns about it. And I had talked to Ken Baxter, who's from the South. So, you know, Ken said, yeah, when I first, you know, I was thinking, yeah. That year, one of the gentlemen in a fraternity actually wore a hood with his fraternity letters on it. So that made it, so that just, right, further supported this concern that I had of, oh my goodness, does anyone understand the optics of this? Does anybody understand what this looks like? Does anybody understand the history of what this looks like and what people could attribute this to? And so I started talking I could travel all over and meet with alumni of all races and ethnicities. I started asking alumni about it. And some of the stories that I heard over time of what people had done during that again, made me further and the fact that then what happened was a lot of the black students said, we just didn't go. We didn't participate in it, right? So they stopped even participating in the torchlight ceremony. And so in addition to the safety concerns, where it was literally fire, and again, real torches wrapped around with kerosene, whatever, yeah, and kerosene, and I'm thinking, oh my God. So I pulled up in a president's council meeting one day, Meg, images that I had at the meeting, and I passed them around. I said, so what do you all see here? And they were like, well, these are KKK rallies and torchlight ceremonies. I said, now tell me, which one is the Eureka College one? Because one of them was a picture that I had from Eureka College. They look exactly the same. So that's, again, one of those opportunities for conversation. Students were not happy, yeah, about no longer you're having this tradition. And I'm saying, do you all know what's gonna happen if anybody finds out that you are doing this here? Do you all know what this, do you all know that you will never get another, this will be a major issue, right, for this college moving forward. And I remember, you know, talking to some of my partners and allies about it and going to talk to Junius about it and coming in and talking to Chef. I remember talking to people about it and saying, hey, can you help me with this? Can you help me to kind of contextualize this? So that's one of those things where it's an opportunity for dialogue, where you think people would just know, oh, but if that's not your experience, and if you're looking at it only in this way, you need other people to help you see it right, in a broader context. But anyway, that's something, again, organizationally, in a community context, that's the only way we're gonna be able to do it, is in a community context. And everybody knowing that nobody, and that I'm not coming with malice in my heart when I say we should no longer, right, do that. I'm coming with, right, the fact that I don't wanna have the illusion of inclusion. Right, and that for me was at the top of the list of something that was all about the illusion of inclusion, because I was like, I don't know if I even feel included at that moment.
Right. And it's bringing silenced voices to the table.
Yes, right, which right. is very important.
Which is what has happened. Right?
Yes.
Students doesn't feel like
they just said they weren't going to say anything
about what this looks like.
Yeah, so they talked in quiet corners.
I would just say, I would echo what Dr. Wright had said about shooting for the moon. Be willing to think outside of the box, and don't think that any ideal is too big for us at Eureka. I would say that from my perspective, being here for a little over 4 months now, 5 months, going on 5 months now, is that I think that sometimes we get stifled by our own traditions. I've said this a lot of times, and so people can't see beyond what they know and what's been passed down. One of the reasons why I decided to come here is because I saw so much potential at this place. One of the things that I fight every day is that we get in the way of reaching our potential. And I say we, because I'm owning that, right? Like, we get in the way of reaching our potential by saying, well, are we sure we can do that? Or is there money for that? Or, and I'm not making light of the fact that we have to have money to do things, but I would challenge you all to think outside of the box, because if you come with a great idea to my office, I'm gonna figure out how to make it happen. And that's no doubt. So I would say that in terms of closing organizations, that I think that working together, working outside of the box, and working collaboratively is important. I mean, I can't echo more than what Dr. Wright has said. So I think those are important.
Now, you hear a lot of talk about how important interdisciplinary education and interdisciplinary knowledge is. Think about this. On the weekend, a theatrical production has led to a discussion that impacts sociology, economic inequality, criminal justice reform, politics, communication, the way that we view one another, the way that we talk to one another. This is what the liberal arts is all about.
Can I add one thing to that?
Sure.
It shifted people's cognition too, because there were people who weren't paying attention or had just kind of blocked that they got put in their face. Sorry.
You know, if you think about it, let's say you go to an art museum and you're staring at a Rembrandt or a Van Gogh, and one of the questions you're probably asking yourself is, you know, how did they do that? How did they create that? You know, in the creative process, all sorts of things can take place. And one question that I'd ask you to think about is, imagine if this play, instead of Chandler being an African-American woman, imagine if this play was telling the story of an African-American male in Chicago, would it have the same effective response that it did by creating a gendered view of the issue? You see, sometimes the arts, literature, just knowledge itself will sort of catch you off guard. And it's in those moments sort of vulnerability where you suddenly start seeing the world differently.
That's where you learn.
So I'll leave you all. The Ferguson Commission sent me this. There was one of the things that you're talking about, you're talking about liberal arts broadly, but all the different areas that this touches. Artists came out in full force as a community and really showed a lot of expressions like Naomi did for the MLK program too. I wish you had brought your painting here too to show everyone. But they sent this, and there's a little sign, a little note on the back. And I leave you all with this, because a lot of people talk about unity all the time. We talk about it, what is it, how do you do that, and all that stuff. But part of this, and I won't read the whole thing, but it says, "Forward through Ferguson is a reminder that when we reach out across the lines that divide us, remarkable things can happen." And ultimately, that's what we need to do, is reach out, right, beyond those lines of things that divide us, and be willing and able to be comfortable with difference. It's okay that we're different. It's okay that some women are redheads, some are blondes, some are brunettes, right? Some have braids. That's okay, right? It's okay that people are different, come from different places, and have different perspectives. At the end of the day, it's the willingness to be vulnerable and understand that we are all ignorant to an extent, and be willing to push through that so that we can make remarkable things happen too. So that's how I perceive this whole notion of unity, as a simple word, yet a very complex kind of thing to enact and have and to implement across the campus community. But nonetheless, this is our community and we're all responsible. So I thank you all again for being here too. So, and my fellow panelists, I think they did a great job.
Thank our panelists.
So hope to see you at the next opportunity.